Hachette Audio presents Hurts So Good, The Science and Culture of Pain on Purpose. Written and read by Leigh Cowart. This book is dedicated to my fellow masochists and to CGC, who knew I had it in me. Introduction. We have company coming over. We'd better get out to the shed now. Earlier today, I had been crying in the parking lot of a fabric store, my slide into the familiar despondency of seasonal depression proceeding apace. But at this moment, I am pert and excited. I follow him barefoot on a worn path through the long, wet grass in his yard. He's been running space heaters in the outbuilding of his house in preparation for our time there. A touching gesture, but a tease nonetheless. He knows how much I hate the cold. And seeing as we're standing here, because I've asked him to do terrible things to me, the ominous fact that I am getting the niceties of warmth has not gone unnoticed. I have no idea what I'm in for, other than that it will hurt. I twist my feet together. He's jovial. I'm chirpy. We've had a sweet date involving poorly prepared German takeout with his mother, followed by boozy coffee drinks at a red-lit hole-in-the-wall cocktail bar down by the river. My skin is already feeling a little warm and soupy from the bowl I smoked in the kitchen. He unzips my dress. I step out of the black, low-cut scrap of fabric, and he gently removes my glasses and bra. My panties stay on because they're precisely the size of a postage stamp. It's the little things, you see. I'm blindfolded and lying on an antique gynecological exam table, my feet corralled in the menacing chill of wrought iron stirrups. I'm tied down to the table at the neck and under my breasts. Straining against these ropes makes me feel panicky and air-hungry, so I work on my breathing exercises while he slips industrial rubber bands onto my arms and legs. My breath is already shallow, fast. I feel lightheaded with anticipation. Right now, the adrenaline is from the dread, and there is a lot of it. He cultivates this feeling, a gifted curator of my experience. He begins to snap the rubber bands. Right upper thigh near the hip, left inner thigh near the panties, outside of the legs, the sides of my arms, the seams of me. I start out okay, on top of the cresting waves of sensation, but soon I succumb to the reality of the pain. Early whimpering ends in a shriek, and he binds my hands with zip ties. I'm moving too much. Now he really gets going. The rubber bands bite hard. I'm seeing orange and white in the backs of my eyelids. There's this one spot on my arm that gets it bad, and every time he snaps it again, I make a pitiful sound, as if hearing my voice crack when I oscillate between endurable erotic pain and actual physical agony isn't exactly what I asked for. That arm will have some purple tomorrow. The moment fills my brain in a singular way. Like if you could inflate a balloon inside my skull and make it fill the whole area, and the only thing in that balloon was just that one thing. When was the last time you were thinking and feeling one exact thing? Just one fucking thing. Just one fucking thing. I'm sobbing into the blindfold, and he makes me come with his hands, and I'm still crying, and he's snapping the rubber bands again, and I'm dizzy from bucking my scrawny-ass neck against my ropes. The Hitachi clicks on, and he's making me come over and over in a way that is also agony. I'm squirming away from him, going nowhere. It's too much, it's too much, it's too much. I miss the too much immediately when he returns to snapping rubber bands. He does this for what feels like an unknowable length of time, this back and forth, a fury of forced orgasms followed by searing pain. I presume there is a puddle on the floor, my thighs covered in thick, stinging welts. When he presses his body between my legs, it is a relief. I can take more pain this way. He is like a grounding wire. I am wet with sweat and endurance, and it's just me and him and that one thought, pain. Still snapping the wide rubber bands across my raised pink skin, he cranks up the Hitachi to its highest setting, now a brutal power tool. He's shoving fingers in my cunt, fucking me hard with his hand. I'm shaking on the table. Everything hurts. My body feels swollen and slippery, and he leans over me, mouth to my ear, breaking the silence with a cruel laugh. Is that high enough sensation for you, dear? I come around his hand. I feel like I am dying. Things get quiet. My body is ringing like a bell, and the crickets outside sing me back into the room. He cuts off my zip ties and releases me from the table, removing my rubber bands with the tiniest of playful snaps. He takes off my blindfold. He's standing over me. I look up at his big, pellucid eyes and catch them just for a second before he kisses me. He pets my hair. We smile while we do this, my soggy face brushing up against his salted beard. And just like that, I felt bad and then better. What do you think of when you picture a masochist? Is it a 65-year-old venture capitalist, lubed up and squeezed into a latex maid suit, his little ass cheeks quivering as mistress brandishes her whip? Or is it the lithe and timid Anastasia Steele of 50 Shades fame, participating in a style of coercive abuse that bears little resemblance to the world of healthy consensual BDSM? Is it me, crying in the shed? Maybe you see a marathoner running an ungodly number of miles on a searing summer day, stopping to barf in the hydrangea bushes before a playground of curious toddlers, pushing ever onward towards a distant finish line. What about a hot pepper addict, cursing into their curry, pink-cheeked and their forehead wetly glazed with sweat? When I say masochist, do you picture someone covered in tattoos, face aglitter with metal studs and silver hoops? What about the masochists who run into icy water in the dead of winter or slap their friends on the bottom to join a special club? I am looking at you, frat boys. What about a person who bites their cuticles until they bleed? What about tire-flipping exercise clubs? What about ballerinas, boxers, rodeo clowns? Do you see yourself? Do you see the pattern yet? All these people choose to feel pain on purpose. Considering the lengths to which we humans go to pursue comfort and avoid pain, why do these people do it? What do you think they are getting out of seeking pain? The point I am making, both here and in the whole of the audiobook before you, is that while masochism can definitely be about sex, it doesn't always have to be. In fact, very often, suffering for pleasure has very little to do with our genitals and their wily desires. And though it's true that the modern word for suffering for pleasure springs from one Austrian dude's 19th century boner, see chapter 5, the reality is that it's much, much bigger than that. Sex may be the gateway drug to getting us to talk about masochism, but masochism is so much more than kink. Today, when I use the word masochist, I am describing something universal, timeless, human. The deliberate act of choosing to feel bad to then feel better, to feel pain on purpose. People have long used this tactic, consenting to suffer so that they can enjoy the deliberately engineered biochemical relief that follows painful stimuli. It's not weird and it's not rare. This idea of masochism, the human trait of feeling bad to feel better, is not an all-or-nothing proposition. In reality, it's more of a spectrum, or even a series of overlapping spectra. If ultramarathoners are masochists, what can we say about marathoners? After all, they shit themselves too and lose toenails all the time. If participants in polar bear clubs are masochistic, what about people who use the cold pools in commercial saunas? Is it masochistic to blast yourself with freezing?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.